There's something about the countenance of fellow believers. It cheers the heart.
Yes, it does. Amen.
There's other kind of countenances that we face, you know, on a regular basis. And we are thankful also for those who can join us on live stream. Tonight we're in the Gospel of John. Again, this will be our 22nd exposition. Doesn't seem possible. 22. We're going to be in the second chapter, the conclusion of this incident where Jesus turned water into wine. We'll be in verses 9 through 11. Now, in this event, the time has arrived for Christ's ministry to begin. It commences at this point. John is the only one that identifies this particular time. He's been revealed in his baptism. How many people knew it, I'm not sure, but John knew it for sure, and the disciples are with him, no doubt knew it. Jesus was revealed. See, the heavens opened and a Holy Spirit in a visible form of a dove descended from heaven, landed on Christ, and stayed there. Then a voice, God spoke out of heaven. Again, how many people heard this? I don't know. I'm sure John the Baptist heard it. I know Jesus did, because God spoke to Jesus. Thou art my beloved son. Another gospel says, this is my beloved son. And John identified him as the Lamb of God. He that takes away the sin of the world. And he identified him as the Son of God. You identified him as that also. And God has said he's well pleased with Christ. I mean, after 30 years, he was well pleased with Christ. I don't think that could be said in all the world of any other 30-year-old person.
Amen.
But it was of Jesus. You see what length God went to confirm Jesus, that this is the one. See, all of this is telling you God wants people to know who Jesus is.
Yeah, right.
And throughout the history of the world, since Jesus was here, people have had a hard time knowing who Jesus is. Mm-hmm. It's confirmed that Jesus of Nazareth, who was a particular person that everybody knew about, Jesus of Nazareth was the prophet and the Savior and the leader that Moses and the prophets told. You got to see how revolutionary. He'd been there for 30 years. Nobody knew this. That was made known. Now, this is God defining who Jesus is. You don't want to let men define who Jesus is. There's an enormous amount of activity today of people trying to say who Jesus is.
Amen.
He's the answer to your need. He can do this and he can do that. They give their definition to Jesus. God won't allow this. God is the one who defines who Jesus is. And as he started doing this here with John. The problem that's being resolved by Jesus is not just human difficulty. God could send Gabriel or some other angel, some anonymous angel. They could have solved any problem, any problem that mankind had. Enemies, sickness, they could. I mean, he turned Israel over to an angel who took care of them all the time there in the wilderness. And so we didn't need God incarnate to solve our problems. The real problem was that we were dead in trespasses and sins, and we were alienated from God. See? And we were enemies. You look to someone who's not saved and say, you know, you're the enemy of God, and God's your enemy.
Yeah.
This is the truth.
Amen.
We dedicate this to those that say Jesus loves everybody. We just like you to receive that as a present. So what Jesus came to do is resolve this. That's the dilemma he came to resolve. If it wasn't that men were dead in trespasses and sin and alienated from God and enemies of God, not reconciled to God and servants of sin, Jesus never would have come.
Yeah, that's right.
That's the condition that demanded a Savior.
Amen.
So enough of this distraction to other things.
Yeah.
Let all the specialists get off the boat.
Yeah.
The church doesn't need any more specialists.
Yeah.
Let them immerse themselves in a business world, if the business world will have them. That's where they belong.
Amen.
You can be a child of God and be poor.
Yes.
God's chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith. See, you can be a child of God and be sick. Epaphroditus was sick unto death. But you can't be a child of God and be alienated.
Yeah, that's right.
Or unreconciled. Uh-huh. Or an enemy. Or dead in trespasses and sin. Or serving sin. You.
Amen.
So Jesus brings deliverance from both the guilt and the power.
Yeah.
The double cure, as the same hymn writer said, the double cure.
Yeah.
Take care of the guilt.
Yes.
And bestow power.
Amen.
So any other Jesus is another Jesus. Now, I don't think enough effort has been set forth to identify who Jesus is. Contemporary effort has been set forth. And I think the reason is because the people that are doing the talking don't know themselves who he is.
Yeah.
So this is what's being made known. So you've got, this is what's being made known in this incident here, who Jesus was. Up to this time, they thought just he was Jesus of Nazareth. His parents were Joseph and Mary, they thought, and he was a carpenter. They didn't know who he was. But it's going to leak out here to some people. Are going to leave this marriage knowing more than they were knew when they came.
Yeah.
All right, now Jesus says, Mary came to Jesus and said, they're out of wine. That's all she says. She didn't tell him what to do. She said, they're out of wine. Jesus said, look, I don't take orders from you. What did you tell me this for? Is Jesus that hard? Well, ask him some dumb questions and you'll find out. Jesus is very intolerant of ignorance. Just in case you didn't know. I mean, surely you do know, but he'll convict you of it. He knew about the situation. I move when the Father tells me to move. And then he... at the proper time, as he was moved by the Father, because he only did something when the Father told him. See,
yes.
He told you, that's the only time I do something is what I see the Father doing.
Yeah.
And all the words I say is what the Father told me to say. See, Jesus stood right up front with people.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't hand your agenda to Jesus. He's got an agenda.
Yeah, amen.
He doesn't operate by any other. So at the proper time, there were 6 water pots there that were used for washing, according to the tradition of the elders, the other gospel writers tell us. And he told the servants, fill them up with water. And they filled them up, the scripture says, to the brim, which is the only kind of filling Jesus will receive.
Yeah, amen.
Half filling. That just doesn't go.
Yeah, right.
Fill it to the brim. You're going to have something from God, fill it to the brim.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that's happening now that Jesus has told the servants, draw out now some, take a sample, and take it to the ruler of the feast.
Yeah.
So that's where we are now. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water, notice how he says this now. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants as do the water, they knew. Their real work will stand a real test.
Yes, yeah.
If Jesus has really done something, it'll stand a test.
Amen.
The trial, sickness, opposition, it'll stand a test. If what you got is real, it'll stand a test.
Yes.
So Jesus says, let's put it to the test now. He didn't say, now you disciples go take a drink.
Yeah.
Gee, that's what that's what some people would have done. He didn't just told the servant, draw a sample, take it to the ruler of the feast. I want an expert that knows what wine is supposed to taste like, good wine. I want an expert to comment on this. I don't want some Galilean hillbillies. Kind of crude, but that's what it means. He wanted a testimony that what he did was real and it wasn't inferior in any way. That what he produced was the best possible wine or fruit of the vine. Yes.
That's one of the functions, actually, of humanity, to examine the works of God and then to declare them.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Now the ruler of the feast, some versions say master of the feast or head waiter or so forth, but it's the person had charge of the dining room and make sure all the supplies were there and was doing right. He wasn't the main person. He was an employee, but this was his job.
Yeah.
Make sure what's served up to the guests is proper. And he tasted what was brought to him. No doubt to determine, is this suitable? This, well, I see we were running out of wine. Here's some you're handing me, and I know it's some other supply, so I'll taste it to see if it's appropriate. Now, you notice how particular the Spirit is in relating this. It says he tasted the water that was made wine. He didn't say he tasted the water. He tasted the wine. Didn't say he tasted the wine. He tasted the water that was made wine. See, you can apply yourself, taste and see the Lord is gracious. You can apply yourself what that means. But it means you better taste the real thing. The water's made wine. He'll know whether it just looks like wine or it is really wine. There's some stuff that looks like it's real, but it's not real.
Yeah, right.
There's some people that look like they're real, but they're really not real.
Yeah. Amen.
They look like they're Christians, but they're really not Christians.
Yeah.
There's people like that. That's the way it was with this wine. Here was something that was not natural. There were no grapes present. No grapevine present, no branches, no clusters, no vat, no treading, none of that. Whatever is absolutely essential for wine, none of the essentials were there.
Amen.
And yet we got wine in this cup. So God wants some unbiased person to give a testimony to this. If you're a real Christian, let somebody else tell it.
Amen.
If they can't tell it, then don't you try and tell it. Took it to him. He tasted it. Something taken out of a pot that was used for washing. See, the power of deity was in a man so that he could put the power of the grape into a vat filled with water.
Right.
See, this is what happens with regeneration. He's introducing people to regeneration. When a person is born again, they become a partaker of Christ.
Amen.
It's like water turned to wine.
Yes.
Amen. What you've got is Christ's life.
Yeah. Amen.
But you really are nothing but a clay pot.
That's right.
Made for water.
Amen.
But the contents of the pot were changed.
Amen.
That's what happened to you. The content in the vessel was changed. And other people can bear testimony. Mm-hmm. We can take this to other people.
Yeah.
It can bear testimony.
Amen.
That this is not the kind of person they were.
Amen.
Religious men are fond of trying to cause people to be different by a routine.
Yeah.
There's people making careers. They make careers and become wealthy, selling methodologies that are designed to make people different than they are.
Yeah.
Turn a drunk into something else. That's like dropping a concentrated grape juice pill in a vat of water and saying this is good wine. There's too much of this. We need the gospel, you know.
Amen.
Not these human wisdom pills.
Yeah.
Don't need those. You may get the faint taste of a grape if you put a little concentrate in there, but it won't be what you serve up to guests.
Yeah, that's right.
Now it says he knew not whence it was. Where it is? Which means he must have had knowledge of all the available wine supply.
Yeah.
He didn't know. He didn't realize where it came from. This work was so unique, it could only actually come from one source. He didn't know the source of it. The thing he will be required to do is confirm the reality and superiority of the product.
Yeah,
that's his role. That's his role. Make a pronouncement on what my son has done here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Make a pronouncement. And yet, even Pilate said, I find no fault. I mean, I made an examination, and this like wine.
Yeah, that's right.
I find no fault. Mm. After Agrippa had heard Paul's defense, he saw, this is a trumped up charge. He says, if this man hadn't appealed to Caesar, he'd been let go by now. See, he had the real thing.
Yeah.
He knew not whence it was. There are still works done by Jesus that aren't recognized as legitimate by the world. I want to make a point here. They don't know the source of it, but they know this is legitimate. Now, Paul builds on this. We've got some instruction on this. He speaks of things that are acceptable to God and approved of men.
Yeah.
Not approved by the church, approved by men. Mm-hmm. They'll have to say like Pilate, I find no fault here. This is whatever happened to that person, it's a good thing it happened because we don't have to check up on them by the police anymore. I like to tell people now, we don't know how large our fellowship would grow, but if we all of a sudden had 1,000 people more, you wouldn't have to enlarge the Joplin police force.
Amen.
I'm making a point here. Paul also said, there is such a thing as we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. All right, you examine my life.
Yeah.
You do it. I'll leave it right up to your conscience what you see.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you want to live so you can do this.
Yeah.
If a person's living sloppy, they can't do this. But you want to live so you can do it. Look, you're criticizing me.
Mm-hmm.
Find some fault.
Mm-hmm.
If you got some, they won't see it.
Mm.
Some legitimate. See, the trouble is, brethren, there are too many professing Christians that are enslaved to sin, and it's given Jesus a black eye, so to speak. And I'm really very, very weary of people trying to explain this condition as though it was normal.
Yeah, that's right.
This is not normal.
Amen.
Yeah. So as people are just pots of water being palmed off as pots of wine. But they're not. They're pots of water. They're pre-Jesus pots.
Yeah.
So he didn't know where this come from. But how about this word? But the servants knew. They knew what they poured in, and they knew what they drew out. They knew where it came from. Some people say they didn't know. Some theologians and commentators say they didn't know what it was. They didn't know this was wine. They just did what the master said. But if that was true, which it isn't, but if that was true, the words which they knew would refer to where they got the water, not what was in the cup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If that's true that they didn't know that was wine, then the only thing they really did know is where they got the water.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. To pour in the vent. No, they knew.
Amen.
They knew what went in, mm-hmm. And it must have looked different. It must have had a different odor to it when he took it out.
That's right. Yep.
They knew, the servants knew. They didn't divulge it.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't divulge it. The word knew here means to perceive. They could detect. They knew. There's no indication they told them. Chief, maybe they did, but there's no indication that they did. That is, they knew by perceiving. They could comprehend what had taken place. What was once water, whatever's in that cup is wine. And they must have concluded what's in the pot must not be water anymore.
Yeah.
Now, the parallel to spiritual life can't be ignored, brethren. When the wine of newness of life is possessed, those who have it know where it come from.
Amen.
They know. Other people might not know why you changed. All they know is you changed. Yeah, but they don't know why. But you know why.
Yeah.
And those who are fellow servants, they know why. See, and a person, if you say, well, they don't believe you. They have to be God not to disagree with you. You just throw that right at them. Yeah. Say, look here, you're making a pronouncement like you're God. And I happen to know you're not God. And if you are, come on and make me a fly.
Yeah.
Or if you really want to begin to make a gnat, maybe you should start with that.
Yeah.
We need to tell people, the people that talk like they're God need to be told they're not God. You do not have the authority to tell me the Bible isn't true.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Or that God doesn't exist.
Uh-huh.
Or that there's errors in the Bible. Mm-hmm. Or that Jesus isn't really a man. You don't have the authority to make statements like that. And if you say you do, you've got to prove it by giving some sign.
Yeah.
And even after you give the sign, if you still say it, I still won't believe you.
That's right.
See, I think there's too much mamby-pamby stuff in the Christian world. People objecting to what God says, like they are omniscient. And people, they argue with them instead of just coming out and saying to them, you're not God.
Yeah. Amen.
Or do you say you are God? Are you God?
Yeah.
Tell us, are you God?
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not, then why are you talking the way you talk? That's the way God talks. God is the one that says this is and this isn't. And God is the one that does that.
Amen.
Well, it says the governor called for the bridegroom. I gather that maybe he's gonna say something to him, but that's gonna notify him probably that we got some wine now. He called the bridegroom. He knew this was extraordinary, but he knew he couldn't proceed without telling the bridegroom. This is his, the bridegroom, needed to know. So he tells him at the beginning, that is when you start serving wine to the people. People serve the best stuff first.
Yeah, right.
Then after people drunk for a while and they can't detect what quality it is, they give them the worst. Isaiah said that the priests erred through wine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We dedicate this to the wine drinkers.
Yeah, that's right.
We always ought to have a little something to say to them, since they say something to us.
Yeah, that's right.
This is Isaiah 28:7.
Uh-huh.
It impaired their judgment. I'm explaining why they served the bad wine last. Because the people couldn't, people couldn't tell the difference. Under the law, a stern warning concerning drinking wine and strong drink was issued to the priests. Do not drink wine nor strong drink. Mm-hmm. Well, we dedicate that to people that say there's nothing wrong in drinking it.
That's right. Yeah.
This is God. God
Amen.
Said this.
Yes.
Do not drink wine or strong drink, nor thy sons with thee, when ye go into the tabernacle of the congregation.
Yeah.
Well, what will happen if we do? Lest ye die.
Yeah, right.
Lest ye die. It should be a statute forever throughout your generations, and here's why. That ye may put difference between holy and unholy, and between unclean and clean.
Yeah. Yeah.
The difference is, under the influence, you become inebriated, and you can't discern between holy and unholy and clean and unclean. Therefore, wine and strong drink dulls the senses.
Yes.
Makes it difficult, if not impossible, to distinguish between the holy and unholy. Solomon said it was not for kings to drink wine, lest they drink and forget the law and pervert judgment. See, it's the same thing again.
Yes.
They got to the point they couldn't tell the difference. So what happens, the person serving wine, abundance of wine, when they get to that point, he brings the junk out because they can't tell the difference. See?
Really,
yes.
You know, I'm sure people would like to read this account and think that Jesus just served a big old bottle of whiskey. But Jesus is the light. He's the one who makes things clear to connect anything that causes confusion or
that's
error
right.
in judgment can't be traced back to him.
That's
so you
right.
got to include, if you served wine, it didn't produce that.
And he's serving wine. Wine, you can get drunk on wine that's not fermented, which is exactly what Noah did.
Right.
Noah planted a vineyard, drank the juice from the vineyard. It didn't wait a year until it had been fermented in a vat.
Right.
He drank it right away, but wine ferments in the person once it is consumed. It ferments within and makes the person drunk. That's what they thought happened to those at Pentecost. They were drunk with new wine.
Uh-huh.
See?
That's right.
It overindulged it, in other words.
Right.
Well, you've kept the good wine until now. How's that for not following convention? This is the wine of the highest quality, and it's the last wine you served.
Uh-huh.
And they probably won't drink as much of it either.
Uh-huh.
Now, I want to make a comment about religious hype, which is current, catering to the fickle preferences of carnal people. Like pumping people up. It's generally with music.
Yeah.
You know, pump them all up. Get them drunk.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's what happened.
Yeah.
They get drunk on hype.
Yeah.
They look for appealing to seeker friendly people, whoever that is. I don't think, if they're seeker-friendly, how come you got to appeal to them? It's an oxymoron.
That's right.
You don't appeal to seeker-friendly. You give them what they're seeking.
That's right,
yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Of course, sin makes a person ignorant, as you know. So when this has been served up, this hype, the people are set up to receive the cheap stuff. And there's hardly any exception to this. People that resort to this pump them up with the drum beat or whatever, they always are fouled up on their doctrine. They embrace weird. You can hardly believe the things they embrace. Why? Because they've been inebriated by hype. Artificial hype. See, there is a legitimate hype that comes from the spirit, where you're exhilarated. See, but this other is manufactured hype.
Amen.
And is always followed by something shallow. If you've been involved in this, you know this is the case. It always follows something shallow. See, the manner of the Lord is illustrated in this beginning of miracles. The inferior is served first, and the superior comes later. Now, by inferior, I don't mean it's something that has to be abandoned. When you come into Christ, you're not given the riches of wisdom and knowledge right off the bat. This is not what happens. You're given enough to get you to growing, but you've got to have root.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen. Even if you receive the word gladly, you have to have root.
Yes.
And when you get the real stuff, that's when you confirm your seriousness about this. When you've made the adequate separations, you've developed a hunger and thirst for righteousness, then God will begin to open up these things to you, but not until. Because it'd be like giving a hammer to a baby. They destroy everything in their path. This is God's manner now. So this is how God works. As you grow up into Him in all things, then... Now listen, brethren. A great number of you, if not most of you, have actually experienced this. You've actually experienced this now. That then you begin to learn about the riches of His grace, the unsearchable riches of Christ, the riches of the full assurance of understanding. See? This is the latter serving. The unsearchable riches of Christ. The treasures of wisdom and knowledge, life more abundantly, knowing the exceeding riches of the exceeding greatness of the power of us were to believe, exceeding joy, exceeding great and precious promises, comprehending the height and length and breadth and width. See, this all is the latter.
Yeah, that's right.
This isn't what you get when you're baptized. You don't.
Yeah.
You have to grow.
Amen.
You have to become rooted. But then when you are, the very best is brought out to you. See,
amen.
That's how God works. This is how He works. See, some people dawdle around in the world. They live at a distance from God. They're not really dedicated to the Lord. They're not really living for Him. And so then they wonder why it's hard to learn. That's why it's hard to learn.
Yeah.
God doesn't serve this stuff to babies.
Yeah.
But it is intended for all the children. It is intended for all the children.
Yeah.
But you have to come to the point where you can receive it. None of these things, these exceedings and so forth, are experienced by novices. None of them are. We may like want them to be, but they aren't. They just aren't. That's the way it was. You didn't know them when you were a novice, and neither does anybody else.
Yeah, along with that type that you're opening up, he did use water the purification, I mean, the purified water. He didn't say, go over there and get some water somewhere else. It was a specific water.
That's right.
That he worked with. And you talked about baptism. He's working to give and to make the people that have been purified through faith and come in obedience to him.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Now then, John makes a comment about this whole incident. That's all the details you have about it. This beginning of miracles.
Mm-hmm.
This beginning. See, there's church traditions that have Jesus working miracles the first 30 years when he was a boy and that. But this is the beginning of miracles. Other verses read the beginning of signs. Or the first of his miraculous signs, or the first of his signs, or the first miraculous sign. God's Word Bible says he began to perform miracles. Living Bible says Jesus' first public demonstration of heaven-sent power. His wonder works, the first of the signs of his mission. Now, what is a miracle? Let's comment on that. It's more than something supernatural. It's supernatural, but it's something more than supernatural. Satan can work supernaturally. The same word used here is used to describe Satan's works. I give you the text. It was signs or miracles that Satan worked. His signs speak of his character and intent. His signs reveal who he is. Christ's signs reveal who he is. See? Now, if you ever work a sign, it'll reveal who you are. The beginning of miracles presented the ministry of Jesus as having to do with making people different. See, his first miracle, he made something different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was his first. His first work.
Mm-hmm.
He took something natural and changed it supernaturally.
Amen.
See, that's what Jesus is up to. He's making newness of life.
Mm-hmm.
Newness of life. Different characteristics, freshness, perception, and abundance. See, it's different. Just as the wine that he made tasted different than the first wine the people drank, so Jesus produces a life that's different than our original life. It's different. There's a marked contrast between what we were and what we are in Christ. We were enemies. We were alienated. We were dead. We were servants of sin. We were blind. All right, Jesus worked, wrought newness of life. And now we're reconciled. We're one with the Lord. We're alive unto God.
Yeah.
We're servants of righteousness. And we can see.
Amen.
Not because of what we did. Because of what he did.
Amen.
See, the water wasn't turned to wine because the servants drew it out.
That's right.
It was turned to wine because Jesus turned it. Just the same, you were not changed because you went through a particular routine. You were changed because Jesus changed you.
Yeah.
Not everyone who goes through what they call baptism is changed.
That's right.
Simon the sorcerer wasn't.
That's right.
Simon the sorcerer heard Philip preach and he believed and was baptized.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't long till Peter said, you don't have part or lot in this matter.
That's right. Amen.
It wasn't that his baptism didn't take.
Uh-huh.
I've heard people say, I don't know if my baptism took or not.
Uh-huh.
The effects are the signs that Jesus is who God declared him to be. See, God said who Jesus was, and so when he worked signs, that confirmed Jesus was precisely who God said he was. Not he was what people thought he was. John says he manifested forth his glory. Revealed his glory. Let his glory be seen openly. It's not clear in the text how extensively Christ's glory was known. We don't know, like everybody at the feast, it doesn't go into that at all. Maybe the servants told everybody, I don't know, but it doesn't say so. I'm not sure that's why it was worked. Indications are it was worked for his disciples primarily. Christ's glory was made known. It appears as though only the servants knew. And the disciples picked up on it also. His glory was an overt or outward demonstration of who he was.
Amen.
It wasn't like an idea or a thought. It was an observable thing that was done that proved who Jesus was. Now see, if that was the standard test today, I mean, there wouldn't be many people who would pass the test.
Yeah.
But Jesus passed the test.
Amen.
What he did proved who he was. No one could have concluded by beholding him before this that he had this kind of power.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. People were raised with Jesus. They knew Jesus. They knew his Mary and Joseph and his brothers and his sisters. They had no idea that Jesus had this kind of power.
Yeah.
But he did. There's still people who have no idea Jesus has this kind of power.
Mm-hmm.
They go to other people to get changes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. To have changes wrought. They go to other people.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because they don't know what Jesus can do.
Amen.
Why don't they know? They haven't heard.
Mm-hmm.
Faith comes by hearing. Nobody can trust in a Jesus they haven't heard about.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, the sign, the true sign is the gospel itself is a sign.
Mm-hmm.
The gospel itself becomes the primary proof that Jesus is the Christ. Because when you believe the gospel, it's the power of God unto salvation.
Yeah.
So it proves, what the gospel did in you proves that Jesus is who God said
Amen.
He was.
Right.
Record God's given to his son. It says his disciples believed on him. Now this is the first time in the Gospel of John that someone is said to believe on Christ. This is the first time. Prior to this, he said of John's ministry that through him, John, all men might believe. He also wrote that God would give power to become sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. None of the other gospel writers report anyone believing on Christ at this point. Never said anybody believed on Christ up to this point. Categorically said. We're persuaded that there's some way in which they believe, so this is the one, you know, and so forth. But I'm talking about a statement made to this. Now here's something to think about. I don't believe the prophets ever mentioned the Messiah working miracles. I spent some time trying to find where they did. I couldn't find any. But they said that he'll work signs and wonders and miracles. The prophets did say that he would come in the strength of the Lord. They did say that. The matter of signs was introduced by Moses.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Remember, he asked the Lord, "How will they know it's me?" He says, "He gave him this: throw the rod down, become a serpent, take your hand, became leprous, take it out." Those were signs
right.
that Moses was who he said he was,
right.
A messenger from God. He believed on him. I gather that this means that their faith became more firm, so they trusted in him.
Amen.
They trusted him. See, there comes a point in time when your faith drops down and is rooted. And grounded. I know it was some time before I experienced this, before I could actually depend on Christ. People say we ought to depend on Christ, and I was one of those too that said that we ought to. But there comes a time. You spend enough time with Jesus, there comes a time when it's not ought to anymore, it's that you do.
Amen.
That's the kind of believing that's
right.
Here.
Amen.
The faith became rooted and grounded. See, faith ranges from weak faith, he that's weak in the faith, Romans 14, to those that are strong in the faith, Romans 4:20. See, so this is a lot of a lot of area there for growth. No one who first comes in Christ comes in strong in the faith.
That's just,
we wish they did. Maybe this would be nice to say we ought to be and all that, but the truth of the matter is they don't. That's not how you come in any more than a baby comes in to be able to eat and walk and run.
Amen.
You start out because God's got to show people. He's got to show you something.
That's right.
He's not going to give you the riches that are yours until you can perceive them.
Yes. Amen.
And be able to give proper thanks for them.
Yes.
He's not going to give you blessings like you give a child toys.
Uh-huh.
This is not how it works.
Right.
Yeah. He gives you the best last.
Amen.
There comes a time when maybe, I think in my own life, I could actually put a time on when I believed in him in this sense.
Yes.
It was in 1960. Yeah. And I can remember when all of a sudden my faith, the root dropped down and took hold. And boy, nothing could shake me anymore. Yeah, well, it's important this happens for you, too. It can have. If it hasn't, it can.
Yes.
It's designed. Faith is designed to keep on growing until it's rooted.
Amen.
And you become like a cedar of Lebanon.
Amen.
Versus a little sprig
growing
out of the ground.
Amen.
So they believed on him. Now, that means they saw a lot. They saw a lot in this. I guess so.
Yes.
If the waitress, you're at a restaurant someplace, and they serve you this traditional glass of water, and somebody comes over and upon his word that all of a sudden is milk.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Of course, you would think it was a trick.
Yeah.
But see, this, they didn't think that here.
That's right.
Because they gave it the taste test.
Uh-huh.
See, you got to have the taste test. Taste,
right.
Taste and see.
Yeah.
Taste and see. Give it the taste test. If what someone says is from God, really is from God, give it the taste test.
Amen.
Does it taste right?
Yeah.
Or is it kind of bitter?
Mm.
See?
There's also an overabundance that's associated with the real thing.
Mm-hmm.
That you just don't get.
That's right.
Amen. Yeah, Brother Given, when you make a profession of faith and you submit yourself to Christ, that's one thing. But when he starts working in you, when you notice, hey, this is not only don't I want to sin, but I'm realizing that if I stay with Christ, I don't have to, and all these things. You actually have a desire to please God. See, you start trusting in him.
That's right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, instead of the disciples of Christ, after he rose from the dead, this is after he rose from the dead, it says they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said about rising from the dead. This is this is after he rose from the dead. That's the latter wine.
Yeah.
They took a sip of the best wines that they remembered.
Yes, amen.
And believed the scripture.
Yes.
See? Now, if it hasn't come yet, a time will come when there are scriptures that maybe now they're a little difficult, but there'll come a time you'll be able to believe them.
Yes.
You'll be able to launch out on them. Mm-hmm. Trust, I'm telling you the truth, brother.
Amen.
There'll come a time you'll just be able to step out on the water.
Yeah.
Back in 1957 to 1959, I ministered to a church in Dallas City, Illinois. It was on the Mississippi River. The Mississippi River at that point was 1 mile across, and across the river was Burlington, Iowa, all the way across. Now, in the winter, the Mississippi River froze solid all the way across. And whereas you'd have to drive 20 miles to get to Burlington, you could walk 1 mile to get to Burlington. I never knew if this story really happened or not, but it was like a legend that was told in town. If there was a man that didn't realize how thick this ice was, and he commenced to walk to Burlington across the Mississippi, and the ice cracked, and he is too far to go back to shore, and he got down on all fours, hands and knees, to distribute his weight, and he'd been inching his way along, and it cracked again. He got down, he's on his belly, distributing his weight. All of a sudden, he heard a big noise and a team of four horses pulling a sled with eight people in it passed by him. He didn't realize how thick that ice was. There are still people, they don't realize how strong Christ is. But we say they can. Mm-hmm. They can come to the point where they can trust Christ to do what can't be otherwise done.
Yes,
amen. And we're touching on that in our prayers here. We pray for things that if we could solve it, we'd just go out and solve these things. But we can't. But there comes a time when we're persuaded Jesus can. And when that time comes, God will hear what you say. Boy, that's good stuff. I don't mind telling you.
Amen.
I think that's. I'll close there. Any of you have a word you'd like to add tonight? Yes.
I was thankful for some thoughts considering the servants who drew the water, but they knew what had happened.
Yeah.
Here you had said, when the wine of newness of life is possessed, those who have it know that it did not come from any natural process or methodology. And I was considering that because it's because that we've tasted and seen that the Lord
that's
is good.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And the others who don't know, it's because they have not yet tasted. But if we mm-hmm. live our life in such a way that no matter where we are, Christ can be seen in us,
mm-hmm.
then it could stir up a desire
that's
in
right.
those who are watching.
Mm-hmm.
People are always watching you.
That's right.
Watching, so it could stir up a desire in them to taste and see.
Amen.
That's
well.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
Exactly right. Justin?
Now, back in those days, they didn't have preservatives.
Yeah.
They didn't have refrigeration.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, grape juice wasn't a common commodity by any means.
Mm-hmm.
So, it says, every man at the beginning does set forth good wine, and when the men have well drunk, then that which is worse.
Yes, worse.
Thou hast kept the good wine until now, but wait. They did serve the good wine first, or
yeah.
what they considered to be good
that's
wine.
That's right, what they considered.
Yeah.
So, what the world considers to be good wine
right.
is very bad wine
that's
compared
right.
to the freshness.
Amen.
That's the whole point.
They
is that
the best wine, what Jesus served.
That's right.
That, see, that totally destroys the whole argument that, well, Jesus turned water into wine, so drinking alcohol's. They totally missed the point that it's. He produced something that wasn't contaminated.
That's
right.
right.
It was completely fresh.
Yes.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, they thought they served the best wine.
Yeah, that's right.
till a chief of the feast tasted that wine.
Yeah, amen.
Then he says, well,
yeah.
we didn't have access to this supply.
Yeah, amen.
I was glad for what you said about signs. I think I've always thought too shallow about what a sign is. It's not just something to catch attention or to draw attention. In fact, this one was done rather inconspicuously.
Mm-hmm.
Don't tell them.
Yeah.
But the point of the sign is confirmation. I don't know that I have seen that before.
Mm-hmm.
That it's proof.
It's proof. Mm-hmm.
It's
right.
Proof of who he is by what he does proves who he is.
Yeah.
So it's not just something to impress.
No.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And when you think about it, why else would Jesus do something like that?
Yeah.
Not just to be a display, because Israel saw miracles on a greater scale than Jesus performed.
Uh-huh. Amen.
It did, and it didn't change him at all.
Now, this is a sign that these disciples, though their faith hadn't made much progress, they did believe.
They did believe, that's right.
And this was a sign to them to press their faith further.
Yeah,
uh-huh. Yes.
They didn't have to change the kind of faith they had.
That's right.
That's important to know. That's right, Brother G. That's very important to know. You don't switch. There's only one faith.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I've wondered whether or not
these servants stayed servants or if they became disciples.
Yeah. It says it manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him.
Mm-hmm.
I like what you said, though. Now, the servants were blessed because they got to partake of this, and he would have actually this was done for his disciples.
Uh-huh.
Jesus really started ministering to his disciples this way.
Right.
In a way, just about everything Jesus did, I began to think on that. Even when he fed the 5,000, he said, "You feed them." He did it. The multitude benefited, but he was showing glory.
Exactly.
And John
right.
17, mm-hmm. You know, gives us a little index in that, because see that one of his, he reconciled the world to God, but mm-hmm. one of his jobs, Jesus, was to get these men to mm-hmm. see his glory.
It's exactly correct, Brother Tony. Mm-hmm. It was for the benefit of his disciples.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it would have been more widely received. Because he was going to commission these disciples to go out. So they had to, there couldn't be any question about who he was or what he had. So he did it for their sakes, yes.
Amen.
And they were always with him.
Yes.
To my knowledge, there's no record of Jesus working a miracle where his disciples weren't there. Yeah.
In Mark's version of what men call the Great Commission, 16:17 says, "These signs shall follow them that believe."
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
That believe.
Yeah, that's right.
So, if the signs didn't follow, because the believing was deficient.
That's
You're
right.
Exactly right. But see, that people that appeal to that, they act like that's an unconditional statement. They forget that believe.
Well, the signs are not for the unbelievers.
No.
That's right. That are strengthen faith and extend faith and out further than we're currently
Amen. In. Amen. Which mm-hmm. ties into their role in the body of Christ, right?
Uh-huh.
Progress. Increase.
Your progress integrates with your role in the body of Christ. You don't get an apostle's faith if you're serving widows.
Actually, a sign is a hand of the Lord at work. That's what that sign was.
That's
was
right.
Seeing the hand of the Lord. We see signs all the time.
Yeah.
Every time I see a sign, I see a hand of the work, hand right. of the Lord at work in the assembly, then we're reassured again.
It's mm-hmm. like God saying, "I'm here."
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is.
That's right. Yeah.
It's a sign of his presence.
Amen.
Jesus said, "Where two or more are gathered, there am I." See, but now believing that's another.
Yes, that's right.
Whatever, if you got eyes to see, he'll confirm. There'll be things happen uh-huh. in gatherings of two or more. There'll be yes. things happen that uh-huh. will confirm Jesus is here.
Amen. Yes.
Lord, God bless anyone who puts us in memory that Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus has been here tonight. Jesus has been here.
The wind. You don't see the wind, you see what the wind does.
That's right.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
I was reminded, too, of all the brethren have certain things that they've stood up and spoke before us that we particularly remember. And I particularly remember Sister Nikki when she brought up about the water pots and filling the water pots and how we fill our children, you know, and
right.
The Lord turns it to wine. So it's important to make sure that all of us are filled to the brim.
That's something that all of these accounts give you words that you can explain other things by using these words, right? Because the kingdom of God, see, there's the ultimate objective isn't to impress men, is to verify, confirm, so you can use this kind of language to describe any legitimate life from God.
Feast, you brought this out that he was there to confirm something.
Yeah.
He was there to make this analysis and then to announce it.
Yeah.
But you know, I was thinking there's trials do the same thing. And a lot of times there'll be people, specific people, that will be in a trial. They maybe they're your persecutor. But see, they're, if you think about it, they're actually helping you to confirm that you have faith. Now, the same thing happened to Matt and Nicole. See, now, some people would have just said, well, I'm not going to church anymore because what if they break in when I'm gone?
I mean, that's right. What if they break in when I'm there?
Yeah. So, but see, what they did, now that was a wicked thing that they did, and they're going to wish they wouldn't have done it.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
See, it brought out of them what was in them.
That's right.
See, and that, now they trust Christ, but see, now they know they trust
Christ.
That's
right.
Amen.
Yes, it's necessary.
Yeah, Jesus gave something for the servants to do.
Yes.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
He didn't just do this work on his own. He actually employed.
Yeah. Yes.
And he does the same with his people. He gives his people something that they can do.
Amen.
And then he comes alongside and makes it perfect.
See, I imagine the bridegroom might have used him to fill the pots, but he wouldn't have asked him to draw out and take to the take to the ruler of the feast. See? But Jesus will give you to draw it out and take it to somebody.
Yes, amen.
Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Amen. It might be Satan, have you considered my servant?
Yeah.
You know, sometimes that's the person who has that you're put there to show that it's really wine.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Amen.
Sometimes I think it during my preparation for saying something that it's a whole lot better when the Holy Spirit comes in and makes it something more.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you that if you walk with the Lord, you don't have to. Yeah. There comes a time when it doesn't have to be a special intervention. You're just with the Lord.
Yeah.
You can't make that happen, but believe me when I tell you that time will happen.
Turn something that was intended for outward cleansing
into
something inwardly.
Amen. Amen.
That's
inward cleansing,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Brother Justin.
Yeah. Like how it says, whatever he says to do,
do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do it. You know, I was a couple days ago. I went back to work and I wasn't really feeling too well. The guy I was working with. He said, I'm not going to turn my radio on today because I can see you're having a rough day. So just out of nowhere, he's not going to have his radio on. So I started playing some old sermons and stuff and heard Brother Robert's meditation again where he confessed that sometimes he was a little harsh on us kids. But it got me thinking that I wasn't always the best son either.
Yeah.
there were things that stewardships that I was given that I squandered, and there were opportunities that I scoffed at, and it just reminded me that we didn't have to have some sort of family council session for this to work itself out. It's just he followed Christ, and I followed Christ, and Christ shows us our deficiencies, and he shows us the areas that we have to grow in.
I don't know what my father thought about the way he handled my transgression, but it never bothered me how he handled it. Well, it hurt, but I was a sort of kid,
You couldn't correct me with talk. It had to be harsh pain. That's the only thing I got through. My dad knew that. And I'm thankful he didn't back off from it.
It
says that foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child, but the rod will drive it far. Rod will drive it far. Some sooner and some later, you know. All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beginning of miracles of our precious Lord. And what a work it was. It has taught us that Jesus is in the changing business and that he's effective in what he does. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.